Hi everyone, welcome back to Understanding Volumes. In the last tutorial, I covered the basics of volumes in Bifrost. Today we're going to scatter some points in a volume, and I'll show you how to use an animated aero volume to drive particle movements. Here I have a mesh sphere. I'm going to convert it into a volume. As we learned before, we can use a mesh to volume to convert a mesh into a volume. Select store level set so that we can later use the voxel sign distances. Change the resolution mode to absolute. I'm going to increase the detail size to, say, 0.2 just for it to run faster. We can adjust this number later if necessary. To scatter points in the volume, let's get a scatter points. This is the same node that we use when scattering on the surface. Connect volume to geometry, and let's get a point scope to visualize it. We see that when scattering in a volume, we have the space filled with points. We can also adjust the point size based on a voxel property, such as sign distance. Here's how we do it. First, let's create some instances of spheres using the node Create Instances. Create a mesh sphere as the instance geometry. To get the sign distance value for each point, we use the node Sample Volume. Connect the volume to it. Set the property to be voxel sign distance. And connect the point positions to positions. Let's get a change range to remap the sign distances to a new range for the point sizes. The sign distances of the voxels inside the original geometry are negative values, so here I'm going to set the from star to be negative 2, from end to be 0, and to star, let's say 0.05, and to end, 0.02. Get a set geo property. Connect the points to geometry. Enter point size for the property, and connect the change range result to data. I'm going to increase the bounds of the target range to increase the point size. Now we see that the size of the instances corresponds to the sign distance value. The inner ones are larger, and as it gets further away from the center, the size decreases. We can adjust the range to fine-tune the size of the instances. We can also change the scatter mode. For example, we can use blue noise to get a more even distribution. Volume scattering is very useful when we need to fill a space with a large number of objects, such as bubbles. If you want to learn more about volume scattering, there's a link in the description to a scattering tutorial by Bifrost developer Jason Brown. Now let's move on to the simulation part. With the scattered particles, if I want to move them in space to form an intricate shape like this one, I can use an aero volume to drive the movement. First, we set up an aero simulation. Then for each frame, we use the voxel velocity of the aero volume to drive the displacement of the particles. Let's see how to program it in Bifrost. To set up an aero simulation, we can use the basic aero graph. Right-click and select Explode. We don't need the collider in this example, so I'm going to delete it. The source, the solver, and the solver settings are the three main components of the simulation. If you're new to simulations in Bifrost, be sure to watch the tutorial on simulation basics, where I explain the structures of aero and particle simulations and the parameters involved. You'll find the link in the description. Connect the mesh to the geometry port of the source here. Let's assign a material to the aero volume for visualization purpose. Go to Hypershade, under Arnold, select AI Standard Volume. And here select Default Bifrost Aero as the preset. Bring it into Bifrost. get an assigned material, and connect the aero volume and the material to it. Get a terminal to visualize it. If I play it, we see that the simulation is running. Now let's adjust some of the parameters. In the parameters panel of the source here, I'm going to change the resolution mode to absolute and set the geo detail size and fluid detail size to, say, 0.08. And this gives us a higher resolution volume than the default setting. To introduce variations to the fog density, let's get a vary source property. Insert it between the mesh and the source air. Set the property to be fog density. I'm going to enter 0.03 and 0.08 for the min and max. You don't have to use the same numbers. I would recommend playing around with the parameters to get a look that you like. Let's rename the node vary fog density. To make it more dynamic, let's get a vorticity influence and connect it to influence. Now we see some swirling movement of the air. Let's also add a drag influence. I'm going to set it to a smaller number like 0.5 and use a modular influence to create more variations. Set the max to be, say, 0.08. In this case, with the property set to voxel fog density, the scale of influence will be proportional to the fog density within this range. I'm also going to get a dissipation influence and set the rate to be 0.1. Now we've finished the basic setup of the aero simulation. We'll come back later to fine-tune the look of the air. Now let's move on to the particles. To drive the particle movement with the aero volume, I'm going to show you two different methods. The first one is to use the simulate particle solver and apply the voxel velocity as an influence. The second one is to use this advect points compound, which uses the voxel velocity directly as a displacement vector for moving the points. This is a method that I learned from our product manager, Phil Mayer, and this compound that I constructed is a modified version of the one created by developer Jason Brown. Thank Phil and Jason for the inspirations. Now I'm going to demonstrate the first method first. Similar to the aero simulation, get a basic particle graph. Explode it. And delete the collider. Connect the points to the geometry port of the source particle. By default, the solver generates new particles at every frame. If we wanted to stop producing new particles at some point, we select this Use End Frame and enter the frame number at which we want it to stop. Let's do 60. I'm going to decrease the rate to 3. If we want the particles to appear at the same locations as the scattered points, we should change the rate mode to count per point. You don't have to do this, but this can be useful when creating other effects where you need to specify the exact starting locations of the particles. I'm going to decrease the particle size to 0.02. And add a color property using setGeo property. For now, I'll just assign a single color to the points. We'll change it later. We need a lot more points for creating effects like this. So let's go back to the scatter points and increase the amount to, say, 50,000. By default, the particles have an age limit. Here, 2 means a point would disappear 2 seconds after it's generated. For this simulation, I'm going to select Live Forever, so that the points would always exist. The size still looks a little too large for me. I'm going to change it to 0.01. And let's go to the particle solver settings and set the gravity vector to 0, 0, 0, because we want the particles to follow the aero volume. There's no need to add a counteracting force. You can also uncheck the gravity here to turn it off. To make the aero volume drive the particle movement, we use the node volume influence. Connect the aero volume to volume, out influence to influence. It doesn't quite follow the air volume yet, so let's increase the force scale, which amplifies the influence. And get a drag influence to damp the velocity. This helps confine the particles within the air. We want more drag than volume influence force to prevent the particles from flying into the outer voxels that have no Fock density and therefore no velocity to influence the particles. Right now I'm using 10 for force scale and 15 for drag. Play it, and we see that the particles are now following the movement of the air. To make it more colorful, we can build a connection between a voxel property and the color value. In this case, let's try coloring it based on the magnitude of the voxel velocity. To get the voxel velocity where each particle is located, we use the node sample volume, the same one we used to sample the sign distance earlier in this tutorial. Use a get point position to get the particle positions. Connect it to positions. Set the property to be voxel velocity and the default value type to math float 3. Get the lengths of these vectors. I'm going to change the range of these lengths to be from 0 to 1. Get an evaluate F curve so that we can later modify the range using the curve. And we can use the node lerp to calculate the interpolations between two colors. Let's create a second color. Connect the first color to first, the second one to second. Connect the output to data, and we get the color variations. We can change the curve to modify it. Now we've completed the setup of the particle simulation. Let's adjust some of the parameters of the aero simulation to fine-tune the look of it. In the parameters panel of the source air, I'm going to change the fog density mode to set. This way we have some fog density to start with, and it generates the same amount of air per unit time. Let's also give it an initial speed of, say, 50. Set the direction to be up along y-axis. This way the air will travel up faster. Go to Aero Solver settings. Change the style to fluffy. This will make the air look more dynamic. We can also increase the absolute value of the buoyancy to make the air move even faster. Now if I play it, we see a more dynamic air volume. I feel there's too much vorticity, so I'm going to bring it down to 0.3. And this looks good to me. Let's turn on the particle view. I think it looks a lot more interesting now. We can adjust the colors. And let's increase the amount of the particles to 100,000 to make the shape look more opaque. You can try even larger numbers if you want. Let's also increase the force scale and the drag a little bit. And here we have our particle sculpture. That's the first method. The second method is more straightforward. We use the volume velocities directly as the displacement vectors to change the positions of the points. Here's how we can do it. I've provided this vec points compound that you can download. It takes the scattered points and displays them using the volume velocities. I'll explain the details in a bit. Let's get a time node. Connect the frame to the port frame, and connect the scattered points to both points and initial points. And connect the volume from the aero simulation to aero volume. Let's take a look inside. As we learned in the last tutorial, the node voxel field creates a field from a volume geometry based on the voxel property specified here. We want to use the voxel velocity to drive the point displacement, so here I entered voxel velocity. For the output field, the value at any position is the value of the voxel velocity interpolated between neighboring voxels around that point. I multiplied it with a scalar field. This scalar is similar to the step size in the simulation. A smaller number means less displacement per frame. You can play with this number to reach a balance between speed and accuracy. And the scaled voxel field provides the displacement vectors for the points. In terms of the points, since we want the source geometry to continuously produce the points, I constructed a feedback loop here. It works like this. If the frame number equals to 1, meaning the current frame is the first frame, it takes the initial scattered points and displays them. And the displaced points will be the input points for frame 2. From then on, for every frame, it adds the scattered points from the source geometry to the displaced points from the previous frame, and apply the displacement to all these points. This way, for every frame, we add new points and move them with the scaled voxel velocities. In terms of assigning the colors, it's exactly the same as the first method. So I'm just gonna replace the particles we generated before with this new output points. Connect it to both getPointPosition and setGeoColor. Play the animation, and we get a very similar result as the previous one. This method requires fewer adjustments and allows you to have more control of the displacement vectors. Here's a rendered image of the particle sculpture. That's it for today. In the next tutorial, I'll show you how to create clouds using advection. Thanks for watching, stay tuned, and I'll see you next time.